Andy, my dude, have you heard of the magical website builder known as Squarespace?
Ugh, not another Squarespace ad. I feel like every podcast is sponsored by them.
Hey, don't knock it till you try it. Yes, okay, it is overhyped. But actually, it lives up to the hype. Squarespace is like a website fairy godmother. With a click of a button, your site transforms into a beautiful masterpiece.
A website fairy godmother? That sounds interesting. What makes it so magical?
Well, for starters, those slick templates make anyone look like a professional web designer. Pick one, customize the colors and fonts to match your brand, and voila. Plus, the drag-and-drop fluid engine is so easy, your grandma could build a site on Squarespace.
Well, she did knit me a lovely scarf last Christmas. Maybe website design is next.
Exactly. And when you're ready to sell your Nana's handmade scarves online, Squarespace has built-in e-commerce. Add a store with one click, get flexible payment options, then watch those sales roll in. And when she wants to teach others her steezy scarf skills, Squarespace's new courses feature is just the ticket. Nana can set up her curriculum and enrollments and payments in a snap and become the next e-knitting influencer.
Ugh, wow, you really sold me with the grandma angle. Sign me up for that free trial.
Just go to thenextreel.com/Squarespace and transform your site into a beautiful Squarespace masterpiece.
Well, thanks, Pete. Even though it's overhyped, Squarespace actually sounds perfect for Nana's site's needs. Appreciate the warning on the ads, though. I'll brace myself next time I listen to a podcast.
Anytime. Let me know if you need any help getting that site up and running.
It's hard to believe that we have been having in-depth weekly conversations about movies since 2011.
So many great conversations over the years about so many great movies. All that said, producing this show week after week requires a ton of work behind the scenes.
Becoming a Next Reel member gives you access to all sorts of additional and exclusive content. Plus, you're helping us keep the lights on. Just head to thenextreel.com/membership, where you can learn more about becoming a member, which costs a measly $5 a month, practically the same as one fancy coffee drink. And you get so much more.
Every month, we record a bonus episode exclusively for members. Those episodes cover movies from whatever series we're covering at the moment or add to previous series.
Some movies we've covered that only members get to hear us discuss include The Blues Brothers,
The Russia House,
Naked Lunch,
Independence Day,
The Hot Rock,
and Relic, the better one. Plus, members get to vote on what we're going to discuss for those episodes.
We also record additional pre- and post-show content in regular episodes that only members get to hear.
Like conversations about similarly themed movies.
And answering listener questions from our live member chat.
Speaking of our live member chat, we record almost all of our episodes in Discord, where members can chat right along with us live.
Members get access to other members-only channels in our Discord community as well. On top of all that, members get all episodes a full week earlier than everyone else in a private Next Reel feed just for them that includes all the shows in the Next Reel family. The Next Reel, The Film Board,
Movies We Like, Sitting in the Dark, and more new projects on the way.
To top it all off, members don't have to listen to ads. We've already eliminated those annoying, dynamically inserted ads that, let's face it, we all hate it.
We are listening to you.
We love podcasting for a living, and those ads help to pay the bills. Now, we're counting on you, dear listener.
We promise. We aren't going back to those terrible, dynamically inserted ads that don't relate to us at all. All we ask is that you consider supporting the Next Reel family of podcasts with a membership.
Again, it's $5 per month or $55 per year. Just head to thenextreel.com/membership.
Thenextreel.com/membership. Get your access to early, ad-free episodes with bonus content, member bonus episodes, and access to member channels and live streams in Discord by signing up today. I'm Pete Wright.
And I'm Andy Nelson.
Welcome to The Next Reel. When the movie ends,
our conversation begins.
Wuthering Heights is over. I cannot live without my life. I cannot die without my soul.
Don't you see what he's been doing? He's been using you to be near me, to smile at me behind your back, to try to rouse something in my heart that's dead. You can't. Heathcliff's not a man, but something dark and horrible to live with.
Do you imagine, Catherine, that I don't know why you're acting so? Because you love him.
Oh, Heathcliff, you must not do this villainous thing. She hasn't harmed you.
You have.
Then punish me.
I'm going to. When I take her in my arms, when I kiss her, when I promise her life and happiness.
Oh, Heathcliff, if there's anything human left in you, don't do this. Oh, Heathcliff, why won't you let me come near you? You're not black and horrible as they all think. You're full of pain. I can make you happy. Let me try. You won't regret it. I'll be your slave. I can bring life back to you, new and fresh.
All you have to do is to shoot.
They'll thank me for it. The whole world will say I did right in ridding it of a rotten gypsy beggar.
Yes, they'll say that. Shoot and you'll be master here again. The whole county will resound with your courage, Hindley. Go on! Shoot, you puling chicken of a man with not enough blood in your veins to keep your hands steady.
Andy, can you believe we've almost hit 700 episodes of The Next Reel?
I know, it's crazy. And with all the other episodes in our family of podcasts, we are well over 1,200 episodes of movie conversation. It's really pretty amazing that we've gotten to have these in-depth movie chats every week for over a decade now.
And we couldn't have done it without our loyal community of film fans. Their support over the years has meant so much.
For sure. That reminds me, we should give the merch store a shout out. Buying shirts from thenextreel.com/merch is a great way listeners can continue to support the show. Plus, they get to sport our great designs.
Absolutely. I think sometimes folks forget we have a variety of shirts, mugs, phone cases, and more available. In fact, a great place to start is with a shirt sporting the Next Reel's logo.
We also have that classic Fast Times Spicoli Surf School tee, or the weirdly popular Rusty's European Tour shirt.
The one from National Lampoon's European Vacation. Why is that so popular?
Search me, but we have sold a ridiculous number of those. I guess there are a lot of Rusty's taking trips to Europe?
We're always adding new designs based on movies we've covered, like our brand new design for A Streetcar Named Desire, featuring a streetcar named Desire. So if you want to rep your love of TNR and films, head to thenextreel.com/merch.
Every purchase helps us continue to have these weekly in-depth conversations. So visit thenextreel.com/merch today.
And as always, thanks for listening and being a part of the Next Reel community. We've got lots more great movie chats coming your way. We just need more Wuthering, and then we'll be home. There needs to be more Wuthering in general in this podcast.
Did you know what Wuthering meant before this?
No. Did you? Are you a big, do you use it? I don't think I've ever heard you use it.
I've never used it, but I didn't know what Wuthering was. And I just, Wuthering Heights, it was just always tied into heights.
Yeah.
But it actually is just, it comes from the Old Norse and means roaring like the wind on a stormy day.
Yeah. And in fact, it is the name of the property.
Right.
For those who haven't read it or seen the movie, the name of the house, Wuthering Heights. And boy, does it seem lonely out there on the moors.
It's them and what is the name of the property next door? It is Thrush Cross Grange.
Yes.
Thrush Cross Grange.
Now, I have a confession. We both committed to reading the books of these, at least these last couple, and I haven't finished Wuthering Heights. It's so hard, Andy.
But you've started it.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. I think I'm more than halfway, and it's so hard. And I'm relieved that we're actually doing the movie, or because then maybe I don't know if it'll ever get finished. I'm just sort of tired of it.
I found that Emily Brontë's writing style is not for me.
Yes.
It was a challenging read. I had a difficult time getting through it. And, you know, I don't know. It's an interesting story in that it has become so popular. And it remains incredibly, incredibly popular, this story that she wrote. But I don't know. I find it interesting because it is such a challenging story. It is definitely like this gothic drama about fairly despicable characters. And it's one of these stories that it's kind of hard to connect with anybody because they're just not great people. And I guess the book has been considered controversial, you know, off and on through its history for its depictions of mental. This is off Wikipedia, for its depictions of mental and physical cruelty, including domestic abuse, and for its challenges to Victorian morality, religion, and the class system. So
those Brontë sisters really held the corner for challenging culture and class.
I didn't know. Does she have sisters? I don't know the Brontë sisters, I guess.
Oh, yes. Yes, she does have sisters. Her sisters are Charlotte Brontë and Anne Brontë, who's the youngest.
Okay, that's right. For some reason, sometimes I think I say Jane Eyre was also written by Emily Brontë. I just hear Brontë and just, yes.
That's other Brontë. We call them other Brontë. Yeah. It's a collective.
Emily was the second youngest of the four surviving Brontë siblings.
Yeah.
Three sisters and her brother, Branwell.
Branwell, who, as far as I know, was not a writer.
Ah, gotcha.
So, anyway, this was, that's Emily and Emily and her sisters. And so the movie, in terms of how the movie hit you, and I feel like having done part of the book and then jumped into the movie, the problem that I have with the movie is that I just don't think this movie was made for me. It's just, as you say, none of the characters are necessarily likable. I don't necessarily feel like the weird love triangle plays out completely in the story. And in terms of an epic family gothic romance novel, the movie cuts out a lot of the story from the book, right? It's like effectively, I think, half of the book. Because we're missing an entire next generation of characters. And so I just found myself really struggling to connect with anyone and feel an affinity with anyone in this movie in such a way that I was rooting for them. There was no real sort of, I had no real interest in resolution for anyone.
You know, it's interesting. Before I read the book, I actually started my experience with Emily Brontë's story by watching Andrea Arnold's 2011 adaptation with Caius Godelario and James Howson. And that was one.
I haven't seen that one either. So,
yeah. It's definitely, it felt more in line with trying to make something that was more gothic, less romantic, because that one, kind of like the book, it's hard to like anybody in that adaptation. And I'm like, wow, this is a very challenging story. And so that was my first dip into the world of Wuthering Heights and Heathcliff and Kathy and all of that. And I was like, okay, this is difficult. Maybe I'll like the book more, which I also really struggled with. Because, as you said, you're following Heathcliff largely, but it's over several generations. You've got Heathcliff, who falls for Catherine, and then she ends up marrying Edgar because they have money, and Heathcliff doesn't, even though she really does love Heathcliff. And then she ends up having a kid with Edgar. Heathcliff ends up marrying Edgar's sister, Isabella, kind of in the book, at least, out of spite and to kind of create jealousy with Catherine. Catherine ends up dying of a kind of a broken heart, but she's just had a baby. And then Heathcliff and Isabella have a baby. Plus, Catherine's brother Hindley had a baby with his wife Frances in the book. So that you have those three kids dealing with kind of Heathcliff later in life as they grow up, and then they start falling in love, and there's this love triangle between those three. And so there's a lot more to the story. And then we kind of end the story with Heathcliff finally dying of a broken heart. And it does kind of have a similar sort of thing where it doesn't really kind of go off into the heavens with the two of them, you know, Heathcliff and Catherine finally reunited in heaven, but it does kind of feel that way, like he might have finally found peace in death. But there is a lot of stuff going on in the book that we just, I don't know, I think it makes it challenging. We were talking about this in our pre-show chat for members about kind of the challenges of adapting some books, and we walked through a number of them. But in this particular case, you can see why they probably chop a lot of that out, because it makes it hard to tell it's almost like two complete stories, but there's so many parallels in the book. And I think that's kind of what they, what Brontë was trying to do. And I think in the film version, it just makes it hard. And then it's like, it waters down even more, the fact that you're supposed to be really following Heathcliff as your protagonist. And so, but Heathcliff is such a
difficult... Did you ever find yourself forgetting that you were supposed to be following Heathcliff?
It's interesting to see how they end up adapting it. And what I found most interesting with this adaptation, I think I ended up liking this more than you did, is because they move away a little bit from kind of just the gothic drama of it all, and they actually build a little bit more of the romance between Heathcliff and Catherine. So by the time, I definitely agree with you that it's hard to see all the time. They don't do it completely successfully, but as we get toward that last act and we have kind of a lot more kind of those heavy, dramatic, romantic moments between Heathcliff and Catherine as she's coming close to death and all of that. And like, we finally start getting some more of that romance that actually made it a little more satisfying for me, actually, than the book or the 2011 version of it. So in a way, it just surprised me that I ended up walking away from this going, oh, okay, well, I guess I liked that.
That was fine. Yeah. I'm curious how that part of the book ends, because I didn't get there, right? Like, when she gets closer to she's still around where I am. And so, like, it doesn't share the same sort of, bedside passion.
I guess I don't know how far along you are.
Well, far enough along to know that we haven't had any bedside passion at Heathcliff on her bedside.
Well, there's not really passion in the book. I don't know. It's a difficult way to kind of describe it in the book. But in the book, she gets pregnant with Edgar's child, has the baby, but then she kind of falls sick. And, meanwhile, Heathcliff has been married to Isabella. But Heathcliff does come to her bedside in the book as she is dying. And he is there as she dies, just as he is in this film version. It's just not quite as romantically portrayed as it is in the film. He is there because they really are kind of these soulmates that are meant to be together, as much conflict as they have in life. But then that kind of drives him away. It's a whole thing. But yeah, it that's really the midpoint of the book, really, is her death.
Yeah. And I feel like I'm on the cusp of it.
Yeah.
I feel like it's got to be coming. It's dragging. I'm struggling for her. Please just die. Like, now that I've seen the movie, let's just move along. But again, that goes to say they cut a lot of the book. I feel like I'm coming up to the end of the movie in the book. And there's that. In terms of the adaptation of characters, right? Well, can we talk about Olivier as Heathcliff? Because before I watched this movie, you had told me that part of the controversy was that Laurence Olivier overplays his dramatic hand in this movie as Heathcliff. What did you think of Heathcliff?
It's big. And there was definitely, Olivier had been acting in films before this, but this was really kind of a point where there was this shift for him, and it led to a lot of drama on the set because he was acting so big. And William Wyler was a director who was really not going to kind of take that, and I guess there were a few points where I can't remember. I'm trying to find the line here, but Olivier was just acting so big, and Wyler was telling him to kind of, bring it down, and you don't need to be so big, something like that. And Olivier had this big diatribe about the nonsense of the smallness of film, something like that, and was trying to kind of create this, this moment about how film was so little and theater was so big. And when he finished, I guess like everyone on set laughed at him as to what he had to say. And that was kind of a lesson for him that he needed to maybe not be quite so obnoxious.
Yeah, old Laurence, read the room, Olivier.
Yeah, right. So it took some time for him to kind of figure it out. But he, later in life, he definitely said that it was really Wyler that kind of taught him how to be a screen actor as opposed to a stage actor. And it sounded like over time he really ended up learning quite a bit from him.
Well, in comparing the performances of Olivier and David Niven as old Edgar is, I think, a really interesting lesson, because I think David Niven is such an understated performer, and he's probably overstated given his, given who he ends up being over the arc of his career. But in this movie, he feels particularly understated in comparison to Laurence Olivier, who feels to me, to character, overwrought. It did not, that part of it did not take me out of the movie. I do enjoy watching these guys on screen in this movie, right? Like, even though I say, and I stand by this part, that the movie was not necessarily made for me, but I do enjoy their performances on screen. And and I didn't find myself taken out by anything, you know, anything I would criticize as Laurence Olivier as overacting. He is a dramatic actor, and he does that. He is, what you get from Olivier is written on the tin. It is that's his brand, and I enjoy that. He is a powerful, big performer, and I thought he was great.
Well, and it fits, and as you said, like, it fits so well with the nature of who Heathcliff is. Heathcliff...
haunted.
Heathcliff, yeah. Not just haunted, but, I mean, Heathcliff, you know, he's brought into the house by Dad as this... I mean, in the book, he's kind of described as, I can't remember, it was like, as like a gypsy child or something, just like living on the streets. And so he's wild. He's brash. He doesn't hold back. And he just, like, everything that he does is big. And that works so well with Olivier as a performer. Like, it just fit to a T with everything that he brought to the screen and to his performance.
Yeah, I totally agree. So I came away thinking, okay, I think maybe the criticisms of overacting Olivier might be overwrought. For me, he was great. But talking about Isabella and Kathy, we have Kathy, Merle Oberon, and Geraldine Fitzgerald as Isabella. By the same token, I feel like that you could lodge parallel criticisms for the two of them. Although I felt like if anybody was overacting a little bit, it would have been Geraldine Fitzgerald. Again, didn't take me out of the movie, but she was a very big character.
Yeah, but I guess, and this is why I think that this film ended up largely working for me, because it does feel like this kind of big, broad romance sort of story. And when you have a big character like Heathcliff, it works to kind of have the people to play off of in the forms of Kathy and Isabella. And Merle Oberon, I thought, was great as Kathy when she was younger and a little more wild and brash. And then as she kind of tries to rein that in because she wants to live the better life, and which is why she marries Edgar. And you can see that come through, but she always seems to have that draw back to him. And I thought that worked well. And Geraldine Fitzgerald, I mean, we just talked about her at the beginning of this season in Dark Victory, because she is, of course, Bette Davis's housekeeper, best friend, you know, kind of at home liver, like the person who does everything for her, at your personal assistant,
phone answerer, right? Yes.
But she was great in that film, and she was big in this film, and we needed to kind of have, I don't know, I guess for me, she ended up feeling like the audience surrogate, like this is somebody through whom's eyes we can kind of see a side of Heathcliff Edgar would never see, and Kathy was kind of denying, but she was the person who could see that there is this side to him that you could love, and that there was this draw to him. And so through that, I ended up saying, you know what, I liked what she was doing here. She was giving us a sense of a chance to connect, more of a chance to connect with Heathcliff that we really needed in this story.
Yeah, I think so too. And her, you know, if you're going to feel for anyone in this movie, if you're going to connect to anyone, like, her turn at discovering love in Heathcliff is going to be the thing to do it, right? It's like, oh, she's going to be the romantic target for us as an audience. I like calling her the audience surrogate for this movie, because she's where our heart lives as we're watching this thing.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
The other thing I wanted to bring up, though, is the framing device. Now, obviously, the framing device exists in the book, where, you know, we have this, the guy, and he comes, he's a leaser on the property next door. He gets trapped there. He gets sick. In the book, is much more of it. Like, there's, he gets sick, he comes up and it's cold and they take care of him. And then we have Ellen, who tells him the story of the family, and thus the drama begins. Speaking to adaptations, at any point did you feel like in the film that was a necessary conceit?
Well, yeah, it's interesting. And because, I mean, that is definitely a huge part of the story, in the fact that, you know, Mr. Lockwood comes here and is told this story by Ellen, the housekeeper. And that's another reason that the novel is touted so much, because it's a story of perspectives and who is telling the story, and like, are they putting their own spin on it? And when the story is coming from Ellen, as opposed to like the diaries, it certainly feels perhaps she is telling it a little more her own way. And so there is a read in the book that has that kind of tone to it that we don't get at all in the film. And to your point, it's like, what is the benefit of having any of that here by having the story, other than to like make it a little more clear that this is the adaptation of the story, you know? And I'm trying to remember in the Andrea Arnold adaptation, if she even bothered with that. Like, I think she may have completely dropped that framing device, which, I guess there's that element of that she probably realized as she was adapting it that it just didn't need it for the way that she was telling the story.
Well, and that's how I walked away from this version of the story, too. I felt like Ellen's interjections, and she does interject to move time forward, right, were largely unnecessary for me, and an interruption of the story, right, that I just, when I get into the story, we come back as a pivot using the fireside conversation to pivot the story in a new direction. And I felt like that is that's a bit of a shorthand that I just think was a distraction for the story as told. I think there are other ways to move time forward in film, and allegiance to the adaptation for that serves the book and makes for an interesting, to your point, interesting lesson in perspectives that we don't get in the movie. And because of that, we don't need it. Right. I don't think at any point the movie was attempting to assign more responsibility to Ellen beyond just telling the story and moving it forward in terms of perspective. Right. There's nothing at the end that feels like, oh, but Ellen, don't forget, she's the ultimate inheritor and love child of all these people. Right. Like there's no twist that feels like Ellen gets, like, deserves to have been telling the story.
Yeah, we have talked about framing devices in other films that we have discussed over the years. And in fact, I think in one of our member pre-show chats, we probably also talked about some of the framing devices in films that worked or didn't work for us.
I'm sure.
This is definitely one of them where it largely feels like an appendage that it worked for the book for the reasons that it works, and that makes it kind of part of the challenge of being adapted. And here it just ends up feeling like something that they put in because they wanted to have that feel of the adaptation. And it just doesn't feel necessary at all. I agree with you completely.
Yeah. Interesting. Okay. So then we need to talk about our man Wyler.
William Wyler. We're going to be talking about him a number of times this season. In fact, our very next series that we'll be discussing, we've got another Wyler film. So it should be fun as we talk about the best years of our lives.
Are you looking at his IMDb page right now?
Well, I'm looking deeper into it, and I was just trying to remember what else we've talked about of his. And I know The Little Foxes was one. Has there been anything else we've talked about with him?
I don't, none of that matters, because I would like you to play with me the IMDb game, Andy. That's right. I've turned the tables. It's now your turn to tell me the big four out of his 76 directorial credits William Wyler is known for, without scrolling up on your page. Can you, Andy, tell me what IMDb's algorithm thinks William Wyler is best known for?
Is Wuthering Heights on there?
It is not.
Okay.
Controversy already.
What about Mrs. Miniver?
Nope.
Best Years of Our Lives?
You got number one.
Okay.
You only get one more shot. I mean, really, if we're giving you four.
Oh, come on. Well, Ben-Hur, probably.
Yes.
I'm trying to remember what else he's done.
Everybody likes to go to Italy.
Let's see. Roman Holiday.
There you go.
Can you tell me decade? That might...
The 50s.
Okay, because I was going to... Because I was thinking maybe I would end it with Funny Girl, but that's not the 50s.
No, but it shares an actor from Roman Holiday.
Oh, God. What else did he do? I'm guessing that's Gregory Peck then.
Sure enough.
I can't think of what else he did with Gregory Peck.
Oh, Andy, a New England sea captain in the 1880s arrives at his fiancée's sprawling Texas ranch, where it becomes embroiled in a feud between two families over a valuable patch of land. That's right. It's The Big Country.
Gotcha. Never seen it.
Yes. Outstanding. 7.8 on the IMDb scale. 7.8. So, that's William Wyler. Does this feel like a William Wyler film, right? Every one of those movies on the Big Four has a, it just feels to me like a, like William Wyler's fingerprint is all over it, right? To me, it feels like it just has a tonal approach and a scope of a movie. And all of those movies, I think you could say, are large movies in some way, shape, or form. Even Roman Holiday is still has a big scope and scale visually on screen. How does this movie compare in the annals of William Wyler movies to you?
Well, it's interesting because Wyler is one of those directors who people say doesn't have a real signature because he would kind of spread himself across such a variety of genres and styles and everything. And so, you know, he is one of those great directors who I think makes great films. And, you know, I don't know. I guess what I would say when I watch this, the thing that makes it stand out for me is just the way that he works the camera with Greg Toland, like the way that he crafted this story and told and chose to tell the story. It makes it feel epic and big, even though it's not as big as something like Ben-Hur. But I guess that's to some extent, I would say that's what makes me like when I watch this film and I see some of the way that he chose to craft the story, I would say I can see that that's the Wyler side of it.
Yeah, I get that. It's funny, though, when you think about, let's say, modern directors like Christopher Nolan. I see Oppenheimer and I see Christopher Nolan written all over that movie, right? You don't have to tell me that Christopher Nolan made that movie. That movie has his visual sensibility all over it based on everything else that I've seen. Martin Scorsese, same kind of thing. Steven Spielberg, same kind of thing. And Spielberg loves Wyler, but always said he didn't have a distinct style, as you say. Spielberg also claims he feels like that himself, too. I think Spielberg is wrong. I think Spielberg has a distinct style. He has a fingerprint to the same extent that I think Wyler does. Like, it's dogs playing poker. I don't know art, but I know what I like. And that's the experience I get with some of these films of Wyler's, just as with Spielberg and with Scorsese and with Nolan, that they just have a sensibility about them that feels like their stamp.
Looking back to more his era, I would say that there's probably a strong comparison with Wyler and somebody like John Ford, who is another director, yes, who I think makes strong films and has a particular style, but it is kind of also a style that is not as overt as some others. And so I think that's why they definitely feel like a director who's bringing a lot to the films that they put together, but isn't necessarily as apparent. And maybe that's why people say that about them.
I think so. And I think, you know, I mean, God, okay, so John Ford was in an era where, you know, he's making a lot of cowboy movies, but he also, like, just feels like, and maybe that's the reason I keep coming back to fingerprint rather than style, because I can't necessarily put my finger specifically on tools and techniques that they do, though I'm sure there are plenty of YouTube videos that actually do just that. To me, it's the feeling I get when I watch a John Ford movie that allows me to say, more often than not, without knowing, this is a John Ford movie. This is a William Wyler movie. I can figure that out based on the tone
And I'm definitely looking forward to chatting about him in our next series when we get to the best years of our lives. That should be a fun one to talk about.
Yeah, that's 46.
1946.
So that's our next series. Our
very 46. Next series. It'll be the 1947 Academy Awards for Best Adapted Screenplay.
Yeah, outstanding.
Yeah. What now, as far as the scripting of this, though, I guess it was fairly complicated. Obviously, it was from Bronte's novel, but then Charles MacArthur and Ben Hecht wrote the screenplay. John Huston came on board to do some rewrites. But from what I read is he's just like, why adapt this? It's perfect the way it is, which probably doesn't help when you're trying to make a movie and it's a kind of completely different beast. In the process of adapting it, I know you didn't finish it, but I mean, do you feel like you're getting enough of these characters to say, I understand at least what the crux of this story and these characters?
Yeah, I think so. And I think, you know, so much of the adaptation is not what you jam in there, but what you cut. And, you know, I started with, yeah, they cut like entire members of the family. By that token, those were some smart decisions for making a movie that's not 7 hours long, right? Like this was, I think it is an efficient film as a result of what they did. I think the way they manage aging the characters from their childhood to adulthood, I think worked largely for me. And those decisions in the script actually felt sort of advantageous to building the trio of the romance at the end. Again, some of the deathbed drama. I thought they at least made some smart decisions in the adaptation. If as long as, you know, Houston's wrong and they are going to go ahead and adapt this perfect book. Yeah, I think they made some smart decisions. Did you come away feeling similar?
Well, it is incredibly tricky to kind of do this. And I suppose in the scope of trying to figure out, well, we got to cut something and just kind of eliminating that whole second part of the story, I suppose that makes sense. And I know in the scope of adaptations, which we'll talk about a little later, it has been adapted a number of times as miniseries on TV. And I suppose in the scope of miniseries, that's where you have that opportunity to really kind of play those two separate sides of this story opposite each other, you know?
Yeah. Charles MacArthur and Ben Hecht, do you have favorites from their catalog? There are several that we've talked about. Notorious. They're very much, you know, studio writers of this era, right? You know, there's no way Ben Hecht walks away with 164 credits without his name being attached to a lot of studio churn in the 30s, 40s.
Yeah, certainly. I recently, as I've been watching a lot of films from 1939, as in kind of relation to this series, I did watch Gunga Din recently, which is another story that they had worked on together. You know, it's a fun film for the era. I can see why it's maybe not as popular these days with the way it depicts some people in India, but largely it's a fun Cary Grant film. I think he's clearly they're having fun with it. As I look at least Charles MacArthur, I mean, the front page for sure, I've seen that. But I don't know, I guess a lot less than I realized. His Girl Friday also, like, it's amazing how many of these come from the front page.
And that he was, Ben Hecht, you know, he was working with Ben Hecht on a lot of these, right? So beyond, you know, Stagecoach, John Ford, for Ben Hecht, It's a Wonderful World, Some Like It Hot, Gone with the Wind, contributing writer, His Girl Friday. Lots of movies in the 30s and 40s that are super classics, but so many I haven't seen. So many I haven't seen.
Yeah. But in the scope of this story, I mean, it's interesting because it's novels are different as far as like protagonists and everything. But in the film version, would you say that Heathcliff is our protagonist or is Kathy our protagonist? Who are we largely following here?
So it's kind of a good question. I think it's Heathcliff, right? I mean, Heathcliff is the character that, you know, it feels like everything rotates around.
Although there's a chunk where he's gone. Remember, he like goes overseas off to America for a while and then comes back.
Yeah, not for that long. And the whole time I'm waiting for him to come back. So even though he's not on screen, I'm still thinking about him.
Sure, sure. Yeah, I mean, I would say Heathcliff is the protagonist of the story. I mean, he's the one we're still following after Kathy dies, as we kind of see how things unfold afterward. But it's a tricky one to figure that out as far as like how to adapt that in the book, you know, and they, I think they do a decent job of making it Heathcliff. But I mean, you know, we've never talked about Merle Oberon on the show before. I really enjoyed watching her performance here as Kathy. Have you seen many Merle Oberon performances? Do you like her as an actress?
Well, I like her very much in this movie. I have to say, like, it wasn't until, you know, I started clicking through credits to, you know, for this show that I realized I've seen her in some things, and I did not make a connection that I was watching a, you know, a film with Merle Oberon in it, right? One of her top four is The Scarlet Pimpernel, 1934. I've seen that for sure. She's got 60 credits, and I just haven't seen much. The challenge was that I found myself really liking, in terms of the sisters, really liking Isabel, Geraldine Fitzgerald, like more than Kathy. And so, you know, while I like Merle, she was wonderful. I found myself paying more attention to Isabella by the time we got to the second half of the movie.
As I look through Merle's credits, I realize this is the only thing of hers that I have ever seen. I found her fairly mesmerizing, though. Like, there's a draw to her. So she's somebody I definitely would like to see more. But yeah, I mean, I think Geraldine Fitzgerald definitely stands out as Isabella. But I think also that's kind of, as we were saying earlier, I think largely because she's kind of designed as an audience surrogate. And she's easier for us to connect to because of the way that she kind of adapts to the characters.
Yeah. For sure. And she, boy, I mean, she has been around for a long time. She ended up with 91 credits all the way through her last film in 1991. You know, all of these folks had a career, but I think hers might be the longest.
That's possible. You know, she's definitely one of those interesting people who's had such a variety in her career to the point where she was wasn't she Dudley Moore's grandma in Arthur?
In Arthur 2.
In both of them, yeah.
Or was it Arthur in both of them? Yeah, yeah.
She's his grandma. She was in Poltergeist 2, so you just saw her in that over in your conversation about Sitting in the Dark.
For sure.
So, yeah, very, very popular. The other person that I wanted to bring up was Flora Robeson, who plays Ellen, the maid between the two different houses. And it's because I just found this to be a funny little bit of casting trivia. She is in this film with Laurence Olivier, and in 1981, they would both end up being in Clash of the Titans, where, of course, he is Zeus, and she is one of the Stygian witches.
That is it. I can't believe we haven't talked about that movie on this show.
it just cracks me up, like the way that careers, you know, weave and everything.
For sure.
And David Niven, what's funny is there was a scene where Wyler asked David Niven, and I'm not sure which scene, but I'm guessing it's when Kathy dies, but he asked him if he would cry. And he's like, oh, no, I have a no crying clause in my contract. And Wyler's like, you're kidding me. Come on, seriously. And sure enough, they pulled up his contract. Yep, he would not cry contractually in films.
Wow.
Yeah, so funny.
Wow. You know, that's like, there is some deep psychological trauma that causes somebody to do that. Like, there's some fear that David Niven has about crying and masculinity. And I think that's worth thinking. I would watch that movie. I want to watch David Niven in therapy. Would that they had made that movie.
Yeah. We haven't talked about him much. We talked about him in the Bishop's Wife early on. Is there anything else we've talked about with him?
Yeah.
Murder by Death.
Yep. Murder by Death. I'm opening pages.
I have watched a lot of him lately as I've been, again, going through films from 1939. I find him a lot of fun to watch. And then, I also just watched A Matter of Life and Death, which he is also in. And, you know, he's just a great actor. He's just somebody who's very, very fun to watch.
He really is. And he's one of those that he is interesting, entertaining, and so charming. I've seen, I think, a lot of David Niven, you know, as I
scroll through here, it's, you know, practically every other movie. You know, he's one that I would love to do a series on him down the road someday. I think he's fantastic.
Well, he's one of those actors that when you're watching him in a role like here, where he's playing this kind of like this pompous, rich neighbor, he works so well. You know, he fits perfectly in that type of role. And, you know, I think that's something over the course of his career, like he ended up working so well as playing kind of like stuffy British people. Like that just in my head, when I think of David Niven, my brain just goes to kind of that stuffy British person, kind of the representation of the elite. And maybe it's because of something like Around the World in 80 Days, because Phileas Fogg always kind of carried that same air, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. 111 credits. Is that what I'm seeing there? 111 acting credits.
Busy, busy, busy.
Well, we have a lot to choose from. Pink Panther's got to be on the list.
Ah, yes. Cinematography, Greg Toland. I feel like there's a lot to talk about with Greg Toland when he jumps into working with, in just a couple years after this, with Orson Welles in Citizen Kane, because of the way that they chose to shoot that film and everything. But I think, like, as I was watching this, and I've seen a number of his films from 1939, as I've been kind of looking at all these, the way that he moves his camera, the way that he frames his camera, like he's working on capturing so much more in the frame than you see in a lot of films of this era. And it's just exciting to see what he's bringing here, because like there were some just fantastic moving camera shots through this film that worked. And just like the depth of field in some of these wide shots that we have, and the way they choose to have some scenes that are much wider than you would normally get. I was very excited to kind of see this film. It was just like the cinematography was stunning. What did you think of Greg Toland and the work he brought?
It's super luscious. And I think, you know, especially when we have establishing shots of the property itself, anytime we're kind of locked in the moors, it's haunting. He makes really great transitions from outside, like from the way the film is captured outside to the way it's captured inside, particularly Wuthering Heights, which is a beaten down sort of aging property over years. Like we get that it's failing its upkeep as the movie goes on. And I think he uses that very well. It's really what, you know, when you think about black and white, like just it is luscious use of camera living in black and white. It was fun to revisit on a slightly larger than average screen. I think particularly because the sets themselves, I think, were very versatile, right? Like I didn't get a sense that we were working just in a straight proscenium. Like it really, to your point, it felt like they were moving the camera around space.
Yeah.
More than just, you know, shooting inside a three-walled room.
And using in the space, not just the black and white well, but the dark and light. Like,
yeah.
I remember there was that scene where Heathcliff is talking to Ellen, and suddenly Kathy is at the door, and Heathcliff goes and hides behind the wall in the next room, but it's dark. It's like super murky dark where he's hiding, and you see him there because of a lightning flash. And then later, after he overhears what Kathy's talking about, now that she's going to marry Edgar and everything, you have that lightning flash again, and he's gone now. And it's just like the way that they would kind of structure all of this and use kind of the cinematography to help tell the story. It was just beautiful.
I had not made the connection that it was Toland on Citizen Kane. I think that's really interesting. Citizen Kane to me has such a different visual style, right? You talk about fingerprints. I don't know that I would have been able to tell you that these two guys or that this guy did these two films. What are your thoughts on him? Do you have a lot of other Toland in your catalog? Obviously, besides The Bishop's Wife.
As I was saying, like there were a few that I was seeing over the course of 1939. Like the other two films that he did that year, They Shall Have Music and Intermezzo, both had a lot of moments in them that I felt were so much bigger. And They Shall Have Music is just like a story about, like, it's like this music program for homeless kids or kids who can't afford to pay for music lessons to kind of get them into music and everything. And it was a fairly simple, sweet story that I quite enjoyed. But just like, I was just taken aback by some of the beautiful, like, booms and stuff. I'm like, God, this is just really interesting camera movement that I wouldn't have expected in a story like this. But and then go, oh, well, of course, it's Greg Toland. Of course, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Grapes of Wrath is he does the very next year, which is a fantastic adaptation of Steinbeck that is definitely a beautiful film to look at. And then we'll talk about him again when we in our next series with Wyler again, because the two of them worked together quite a bit in the best years of our lives. So
I think if there's any parallel, like when I, you know, particularly when I'm thinking about Citizen Kane, like there's just a lot in the way Kane is handled as a character over the course of the film. It's been a little bit since I've seen it, but his largesse on screen, capturing him low, capturing him long, capturing those contrasts in between light and dark, really parallels, I think, the treatment of Heathcliff, particularly early on in the movie when we're still in the framing device. Heathcliff is presented as this angry sort of, you know, giant character. The camera's low on him. He stands up over the fire, and we get this image of him as kind of this monster of solitude as he's in the house. We learn that that's not really the case after, you know, over the course of a lot of the movie, where we get to see how he became this way. But I do think that there is something to be said for camera treatment of these characters, like Kane, like Heathcliff, as larger than life in the frame that works very, very well. That feels Toland-y.
Well, and also I think a lot of that came from Wells. I think the two of them just worked really well together to kind of craft that story and to do a lot of really unique things in the way that that story got told. But I still think, like, when you look at what he does with Wyler here, and again, I think they worked together maybe six times, something like that. I feel like there's definitely a sense of director and cinematographer who click and find a great language together to tell their stories.
Yes.
The other big technical side of this film that I just am absolutely in love with is the music. Alfred Newman's score, particularly like Kathy's theme, it has kind of all the haunting romance in it that I think works exceptionally in the story. Did you click much with Newman's score for this one?
Yeah, it didn't. I have to say it didn't jump out at me as I was watching it. It makes me want to go back because you have great taste in scores. I don't know why I sort of feel like I missed some of this stuff, but I don't know that I have much to comment on the music.
I mean, it definitely like builds to the great swells and everything, like toward the end after Heathcliff dies. And then you've got this meeting of him and Kathy's spirits on the moors. And as the way they kind of walk off to heaven, it's very romantic. It has kind of that tragic romance to it that I think works well for the nature of the story. And, you know, definitely a little more of kind of I guess you could almost say that was definitely a little bit more of the happy ending that this was Samuel Goldwyn was wanting for the story. I think what I read is that he actually went and shot that ending. He wanted a happier ending than what Wyler was delivering him. And so after the production was over, he went and had that ending shot with some doubles of his two leads to put that onto the film, which... Yeah. I mean, but again,
Wyler,
I would say that that's part of the reason why this worked better for me than the book did. Yeah. So it's funny that the way things work out. Oh, well, any last thoughts about anything with this film?
I don't. I'm glad we watched it. I'm curious how it plays in the overall arc of 1939 history. As we talk about these films.
Well, should we talk about the awards right now?
Sure.
I have a list on our letterbox of this entire series, these four films that we've done, plus the other six that we have talked about in the past. So yeah, if you go to the Next Reels page, we do have a list specifically for this series. The 10 films nominated, Gone with the Wind, of course, won. Dark Victory, Goodbye, Mr. Chips, Love Affair, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, Ninotchka, Of Mice and Men, Stagecoach, The Wizard of Oz, Wuthering Heights. I guess first question, you know, we should also mention in our 1939 series, we also talked about The Roaring Twenties, Only Angels Have Wings, The Women, and The Hound of the Baskervilles. And then, of course, there's countless other 1939 films that we have watched. I, of course, have been plowing through films from 1939.
Yes.
And I think now I've probably watched... How many... I have to look now. How many films from 1939 have I now seen? Let me just look. According to Letterboxd, I have seen 59 films from 1939 now.
And I haven't heard a peep of Mid-Atlantic out of your mouth, Andy. That's remarkable.
So, you know, I guess the first question is, of those 10, if we didn't change a thing, what would you pick as your best picture?
Not Gone with the Wind. I don't know. I mean, I feel like there are of the movies that I have rated, the one that is a 5-star film is Mr. Smith.
I thought you gave Of Mice and Men 5 stars.
Oh, I gave I haven't actually updated that yet because that's for... It hasn't released yet. You're right. I also gave Mice and Men 5 stars. It's succeeding at what it wanted to be. Of Mice and Men is 5 stars. I am not going to give Wuthering Heights.
And I will say, I think you gave The Wizard of Oz 5 stars.
I gave The Wizard of Oz 5 stars. I am validating that right now. So of the movies, the 3 movies that I have given 5 stars are Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, The Wizard of Oz, and Of Mice and Men. So one of those 3 I would put as best picture, and one of those 3 is not Gone with the Wind.
So which one?
Well, I don't know yet. You have to talk now. I'm thinking. I'm stewing.
Well, it's pretty easy for me. It's Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. I think that film works exceptionally. I think in the scope of, especially even today in the world of our politics, I think watching something like Mr. Smith Goes to Washington gives a really interesting view in kind of like aspirational politics, like how we like things to go. Like, it's kind of like, you know, in the world of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Captain America represents like what we want America to be. And I think that's kind of like Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. We kind of want to see that our political system could actually have people like him who actually are able to stand up to the powers above him and still find ways to make things work for the better.
It's funny that you frame it like that, because I think you could make the case that as a fable, Wizard of Oz does something similar, right? Like pulling back the proverbial curtain on that which is not authentic is similar to the mission in Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, right? Like aspirationally, we individuals have power and agency to make change in the world and in the circumstances in which we find ourselves. Both of those movies take on a similar thing from a different perspective. Both of those movies are larger in scope and scale than Of Mice and Men, so I think I'd knock Of Mice and Men out for me. But between those two, they're coming at, for me, a similar ideology, and they're both done very, very well. I would probably lean with you on Mr. Smith if I'm forced. Because of the final speech. Like, I just feel like he's so good individually standing up and doing what he needs to do to make change. And his innocence as he learns the ropes of Washington is delightful to watch on screen. So I think I would probably lean toward Mr. Smith. But I'm fascinated that both of those movies are in this collection and are capturing the same sort of heart for me.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I think I'm right there with you with my three favorites of this list: Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, Of Mice and Men, The Wizard of Oz. I think they're all exceptional and absolutely rewatchable films.
Yeah, me too.
Are there any that you would, if you were given the chance, you would drop something out and replace it?
I don't know that I'm equipped enough, certainly not as equipped as you are because of all the 1939 that you're watching. I think you have to answer
so
that
many,
first.
So many. Well, yeah.
Because right now I watch this thing and I think this is an able list of movies. Like, they're not all my favorites, but it's a capable list of movies that represent the year. So what about you?
And it is so interesting, though, because 1939 is often regarded as, like, you know, Hollywood's greatest year and all this sort of stuff. And so it's funny when you look at these films, yes, I can see kind of this broad swath of stories across them. But at the same time, like, if I were to pick a John Ford film, I likely would put on like Young Mr. Lincoln before Stagecoach that was done the same year. Like I found that film more affecting for me than Stagecoach. I absolutely would have loved to see The Rules of the Game, Jean Renoir's film on here. And I probably would drop something like Wuthering Heights and put on Rules of the Game. Ninotchka, I thought was a fun movie. That's one that I have not yet watched again, whereas I've tried rewatching some of the others. I'd like to rewatch Ninotchka just to kind of see if it clicks a little more for me. But like something that I thought was like an exceptional film from the era was Destry Rides Again, another Jimmy Stewart film, another Western, but you know, absolutely one of my favorite films of the year. And the most surprising film, which, you know, this is one of those films where I would have a hard time picking this to put up on my list of best pictures, but Bachelor Mother was this Ginger Rogers, David Niven comedy that was just so delightful. I had such a fun time. It was just sweet, romantic, and a fun story. I absolutely would say that that's probably, while I wouldn't put it on the best picture list, I would say it was probably one of my favorite films of the year. So it's kind of funny to see like the way that it's just the way that things work, you know. I mean, but I'm looking 1939, my top 10 films are Wizard of Oz, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, Bachelor Mother, Destry Rides Again, Love Affair, Only Angels Have Wings, Rules of the Game, Dark Victory, Beau Jest, First Love, They Shall Have Music, When Tomorrow Comes. And then rounding out just the 4 and 5 stars, Daybreak, a French film, The Story of the Last Chrysanthemum, a Japanese film, and Young Mr. Lincoln. So, yeah.
Interesting. I haven't seen Young Mr. Lincoln, but it sounds like that needs to be next on my list.
I find it, I don't know, it worked better for me than Stagecoach did as a John Ford film. But again, Stagecoach is another one that I owe a rewatch to.
I think that, you know, culturally, aesthetically, Gone with the Wind is stays on the list. It's just aging so poorly for me that it's hard to imagine. You know, if you run it again, I have a hard time imagining that one does anything good. But
there's just such that epic scope. I mean, I can see why it's on here, too, because it's beautiful. I mean, yeah, there's so much. And watching Scarlett go from this spoiled little girl to this woman who's, you know, fighting for her last chunk of land. You know, there is a strong story there, but it's just there's a lot of ick that comes along with it nowadays.
It's interesting, the movies that stick with me, though. You know, like I enjoyed my time with Love Affair and Goodbye, Mr. Chips, but I find myself looking at the list and thinking, oh, I need to really process to remember what those were all about. Like they don't stick, not the way something like Mr. Smith and Wizard of Oz and Mice and Men and even Stagecoach for me sticks.
Sure.
So
yeah.
Good year, though.
Yeah.
Good year.
Lots of good stuff. Lots of good stuff.
I feel in terms of rating relativism, even a 3-star on one of these lists is extraordinary because it's in such good company.
Yeah, although I will say it's amazing, like watching as many films from 1939 as I have been watching lately. Like, I'm like, what is it about this movie or about this year that makes people say it's like the greatest year of Hollywood? Because I'm like, yeah, I mean, it's got its average movies, it's got its great movies, it's got its successful movies, it's got its not so successful movies, but like there's nothing about it that says, oh, well, you know, this over 1938 or 1940, it's like, why? I guess, sure, Gone with the Wind and Wizard of Oz, two classics that remain classic. You know, is that why? It's weird.
And Mr. Smith, like these movies have transcended the cultural norms, right? They still have things that we think about in them that represent other things. Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, your entire speech on what that movie aspires to, people still think about in politics today from 1939. So yeah, I mean, I see how that year particularly has echoes. The thing that is interesting to your point is how these 3 or 4 films actually serve to buoy the rest of the year is interesting. That is the gift of like blindness, like you know, called like just memory blindness. Like we just don't remember that the movies, because it's been a long time since we watched them. Mr. Smith and Wizard of Oz, surely all the movies were great that year because those movies were so great that year.
Yeah, I think it's one of those things that Hollywood really loves, being able to have something like that to latch on to. Like 1939, what a great year for movies. You know, yeah, whether right. it's true or not, it's just, it's yeah. the tagline that goes along is. With the year now.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, well. All right. Well, we'll be right back. But first, our credits.
The Next Reel is a production of True Story FM. Engineering by Andy Nelson. Music by Martin Puringer, Oriel Novella, and Eli Catlin. Andy usually finds all the stats for the awards and numbers at d-numbers.com, boxofficemojo.com, imdb.com, and wikipedia.org. Find the show at truestory.fm. If your podcast app allows ratings and reviews, please consider doing that for our show. It is hard to believe we've been having in-depth weekly conversations about movies since 2011.
You're telling me producing this show week after week is so much fun, but it does require a lot of work behind the scenes. If you'd like to help support our efforts, one easy way is by using our Originals page when shopping for books and movies that we've covered.
Your purchases made through our links give us a small commission at no extra cost to you and allow us to keep having these great discussions.
The Originals page at thenextreel.com/originals links to the source material for all of our adapted film discussions. Purchasing through our links supports the show.
In season 13, we explore various awards categories and the films nominated in them.
We wrapped up our 1940 Best Picture series with adaptations of Mice and Men from John Steinbeck and Wuthering Heights from Emily Brontë's novel, not to mention the play Dark Victory by George Brewer Jr. and Bertram Block.
The 1947 Academy Award adapted screenplay series featured Anna and the King of Siam, based on Margaret Langdon's book, plus The Best Years of Our Lives, Brief Encounter, and The Killers.
The 1952 cinematography nominees included Death of a Salesman and A Streetcar Named Desire, A Place in the Sun, based on both a play and a book, and Strangers on a Train, based on Patricia Highsmith's first novel.
So many great movies based on books and plays, like Beckett, The Pumpkin Eater,
A Boy and His Dog, Rollerball,
The Princess Bride, Congo, The Scarlet Letter,
Jackie Brown, The Deep End, The Gray, The Woman in Black,
and Top Gun Maverick, which I'm very much looking forward to revisiting.
Get the source books at thenextreel.com/originals.
Start your next read or reread from the movies we've covered. Visit thenextreel.com/originals today. All right, Andy, this one I think is going to be a little bit tricky on sequels and remakes because there are 10,000 of them.
Holy cow. Maybe not as many sequels, but certainly in the adaptations, I guess, is really probably the more apt term for this. It's crazy how many times it has been adapted. I mean, film-wise, 1920, this one from 1939, 1950, 1951, 1954, 1966, 1970, 1985, 1988, 1991, 1992, 2007, 2011. And, I mean, not always done in English. Some of those are other countries, other languages, but yeah, there's a variety. On TV, 1948, 50, 53, 58, 59, 62, 98, 03, 04, 15. And then TV series or miniseries, 64, 67, 76, 78, 79, 2002, 2009, 2021. Tons of radio adaptations, 3 different operas, 2 different musical theater versions, 5 other regular theater versions, a 2011 graphic novel, and 4 other loose adaptations. It is clearly a story that people tap into because probably of the heightened emotional journey that the characters take and the challenging book that Brontë wrote that makes people want to see if they can, you know, make their own version that sticks. Crazy.
And don't forget that hit Kate Bush song, Wuthering Heights, and Pat Benatar, Wuthering Heights.
Right. I didn't even mention
My
those.
My goodness.
Yep.
I look at a list like this, and I think, what is it? I, having just watched this movie, I cannot fathom why it has connected so deeply with enough people to make this movie time and time again. And for those people to be able to sell their vision of it time and time again. And for the people they sell it to say, yeah, I'll pay for that again. I don't understand it.
Well, again, I think it just goes to why the book is viewed as this classic. This it's a story about turbulence in kind of this very darkly gothic romance world. And I think there is just a lot of, people are drawn to kind of that emotion. And I it's very heightened. I didn't connect with it, but clearly a lot of people do.
Well, I guess, yeah, maybe it is. It's the Frankenstein of romance, right? Just keep making it. The monster is romance, Andy. That's what I'm saying. The monster was romance all along. All right. Well, we've talked about the big awards discussion, but how did this one do specifically at awards season?
Yeah, this had 7 wins with 7 other nominations. At the Oscars, we just mentioned Best Picture and how this lost to Gone with the Wind. Laurence Olivier was nominated for Best Actor, but lost to Robert Donat in Goodbye, Mr. Chips, which we have talked about kind of being the controversial win because it was a split between... I think largely, was it Olivier and Stewart? And it ended up kind of surprising people that Donat took it. Geraldine Fitzgerald received her Oscar nomination for Supporting Actress for this, but lost to Hattie McDaniel, Gone with the Wind. Art Direction lost to Gone with the Wind. Director lost to Victor Fleming for Gone with the Wind. Music Original Score lost to The Wizard of Oz. Best Writing Screenplay lost to Gone with the Wind. And the one win for this film was the cinematography, Black and White, which, Toland beat out the only other nominee, which, of course, was Stagecoach. At the National Film Preservation Board in 2007, this was one of the 25 films added that year. At the New York Film Critics Circle Awards, this actually beat Mr. Smith and Gone with the Wind for Best Film. And at the National Board of Review, it was one of the top 10 films of the year. Fitzgerald won this for Best Acting and Dark Victory, and Olivier won for Best Acting. And a fun one, the Photoplay Awards, I guess Photoplay Magazine, they would do Best Performances of the Month. Merle Oberon and Laurence Olivier got that award for the month of June, 1939.
Performances of the month.
Yeah.
That's amazing. All right. Well, were you able to rustle up your spreadsheets to find anything about the budget, Andy?
Again, like this... period is just so difficult to find great information. As I said last week, I couldn't find anything. What I did find, this opened April 13th, 1939, opposite The Story of Alexander Graham Bell. I also found that it earned $624,643 domestically during a re-release April 7th, 1989 to celebrate its 50th anniversary. But unfortunately, that is all I could find.
All right. Well, there you have it. That's Wuthering Heights. The Heights, they are a Wuthering. And I'm glad we talked about it. I'm glad we watched it. I think I will, after this conversation, I'm going to finish the book. I promise.
All right.
I just need to put a pin in that. But it is solidly representative of the film. I get that, it's beautiful. It just wasn't made for me.
Well, we will be right back for our ratings. But first, here's the trailer for next week's movie, John Cromwell's Anna and the King of Siam, kicking off the next series, as we mentioned earlier, 1947 Academy Award Best Adapted Screenplay nominees.
How old shall you be? You do not look like a scientific person for teaching of school. How old shall you be?
I am 150 years old, Your Majesty.
Thing for me to do, and I said so positively. Oh, Lord, you will have to forgive your mother. I said we'd have a home of our own, and here I brought you straight into a harem.
What does that mean, Mother?
He asked me, and I do gladly whatever he wish. It is strange he did not tell you this.
He didn't give me any answer at all. I thought that...
Then you did talk to him. And it is you he listened to. If I am not first in this place, what is left for me?
you'll forgive me, it's a matter of great importance. It's Lady Topton, Your Majesty.
Is there nothing dishonorable to me that is secret here?
How shall you like if I make you watch what I shall do?
Are you going to read that one?
No, I don't think I am.
We should each try to at least read one of the books from this upcoming series.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll see how easy I can get it, how quickly. I don't know if I could get through it.
Cool.
All right, Andy, it's time for Letterboxd. But you can see all of our ratings, nextworld.com/letterboxd. You are letterboxd.com/Soda Creek Film. I am letterboxd.com/Pete Wright. And you can follow us over there if you are Letterboxd lovers. So, Andy, what are you going to do?
I definitely enjoy this more than the book or that 2011 adaptation. There's something about just the way they chose to focus on the romance and kind of the tragedy of it that worked for me. It still isn't my favorite, but I'm going to say 3 stars and a heart.
That's funny. As somebody who likes it, I think, less than you, that's exactly where I was going to land, because it's not like I don't understand that it's a fine film. It's a fine exercise in filmmaking. I'm okay with that.
Are you 3 stars and a heart or 3 stars and no
heart?
Yeah,
I'll give it a heart. It's right in the middle. Like, it's right in the middle. I can appreciate it. I don't love it.
Right in the middle would actually be 2.5, but I know you're peak.
I don't do half stars, Andy. Right? I don't do half stars. That is a pox. Well, but that's interesting.
When you say out of 5 stars, it's right in the middle. How do you dance the line between 2 stars versus 3 stars then? Because either one of those technically is right in the middle for you.
Yeah, I know. It is a dance in the line. I think for this one, it's Toland. I think talking about Toland pushes it up to a 3 instead of down to a 2.
Gotcha. Okay.
There's always something.
Remember, you can check out all of our stuff over at thenextreel.com/letterboxed. So what did you think about Wuthering Heights? We would love to hear your thoughts. Hop into the Show Talk channel over in our Discord community, where we will be talking about the movie this week.
When the movie ends,
our conversation begins. I feel like I just want to start naming my properties.
I feel like that is a vastly underused trope. Kira and I have talked about this, and she won't let me get like a plaque. I want to name our properties. For a while, I just wanted to name our house the Wright House and put a big, like, West Wing style placard with just a suburban house embossed on it. And just says the Wright House in, you know, White House font.
Uh-huh.
I thought that would have been a funny joke. She doesn't appreciate that.
Oh,
I know. That's what I said. Oh,
yeah. I'm going to have to think
about
that.
What would you name your property?
Well, that's what I was going to say. I'm going to have to think about that because I actually don't know. I'm going to have to stew on it a little bit to try to decide what would make sense. It's like, we're not Wuthering here. If anything, I feel like it needs to relate to sun and baking and heat.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good point. And maybe cactuses. Would you throw a cactus in there? Like,
yeah, I don't know, like the prickly heart.
You could tell your friends, hey, come on back to the hot swaro for just call it the hot swaro with Andy and Ange.
We'll call it the prickly heart. The prickly heart.
The prickly heart.
Yeah.
Prickly heart. Yeah. All right. Letterboxd giveth, Andrew.
As Letterboxd always doeth.
How did you approach the Letterboxd machine this week?
I went high, and I also ended up going a little more straightforward and serious.
Oh, okay. Well, go. I'd like to see yours.
I did a 5-star by Leo Cart, 5 stars and a heart. And I think this just ties into my feeling about the adaptations that I've seen, at least. And our conversation about William Wyler, Leo Cart says, yeah, maybe this William Wyler guy is the greatest to ever do it.
Oh, that is That's short and sweet.
Short and sweet.
The greatest to ever do
it. Makes me think maybe I don't need to watch any other adaptations.
Pretty much. I think we could put a fork in it. I have a 3.5 star from Megan, who says, look, I'm not one who finds Wuthering Heights romantic. In fact, to me, it's decidedly unromantic. But I'm woman enough to admit that he's more myself than I am. Whatever our souls are made of, his and mine are the same. Goes off. That is a banger of a line. Well, there's one line that totally rocks your world in the movie. That's worth a review.
Here.
It's worth a review.
Here, here.
Although I do appreciate lacked interpretive dancing. 4 stars. All right. Thanks, Letterboxd.